गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू। गुड
मॉर्निंग सर। गुड
मॉर्निंग
मॉर्निंग सर।
गुड मॉर्निंग।
गुड मॉर्निंग
गुड मॉर्निंग गुड मॉर्निंग
सर।
गुड मॉर्निंग। सो यस्टरडे वी वेर डिस्कसिंग अबाउट द कमिटी दैट इज नोन एज द रिव्यू कमिटी फॉर रिव्यू कमिटी ऑन हायर सेकेंडरी एजुकेशन with a special reference to the vocationalization of education. Or better to understand, actually this is the name of the committee, but when you will see the whole document, you will find that they have only discussed the vocationalization part of a secondary education. So it is not a such kind that it's a review on the secondary education. There is nothing such in this report. And the report we have already discussed, that a report was chaired by Macklon Addisons, and he was the vice chancellor of Madras University, then Madras University. At that time he was a vice chancellor of Madras University, and some of the central finding that was recommended by the committee, that we have already seen the four central finding. Okay, so that we have seen. Apart from those central finding, there are some other recommendations of this committee also that we will discuss today, and there are some other things also that we will see. And while discussing the central finding, we have seen that this committee was in opinion that the recommendations of Isbarch by Patel committee, okay, that was a major recommendation, was that inclusion of SUPW in the secondary education was recommended. However, it was suggested that in spite of incorporating SUPW in the secondary education, it will be better to offer the vocational courses as electives. Some electives will be there in the vocational courses, and that should be offered in spite of offering the vocational SUPW. Okay, so that was the one of the major central recommendation. And you will find that even the Iswar Bhai Patel Patel, not committee, the person I am talking, Iswar Bhai Patel was also one of the member of this committee. Okay, Adhisesa was the chairperson of this committee, and Iswar Bhai Patel was one of the member of this committee, because I was going through that who were the member to look into that, and you will find that the several good academicians was the member of this committee. One the very famous Hindi poet, I think those who are from the Hindi, they must be knowing, and their patriotic poems are very famous also. The Shiv Mangal Singh Suman, he was also one of the member of this committee. So let it be those who were the committee member. But I thought that it's always good to understand that who were the member of the committee and what were the recommendation, that kind of a thing. That's why I saw something interesting, and I found that the great persons were the member of this committee to look into the vocationalization of secondary education. So apart from those four recommendation, there was some other recommendations of this committee also, like that the higher secondary education structure, the structure of higher secondary education. They talk about that the structure of higher secondary education should be comprised of general education, vocational spectrum, general spectrum, not general education, sorry, general spectrum. What are those? We will discuss in here also. That the general spectrum, vocational spectrum, or a mixed in the spectrum, mixed kind of a spectrum. What are the spectrum here? It is mean that the general spectrum is meant by the general foundation courses and the language. Like that, when we talk about the language, means at that time we had a three language formula, and so the one regional language, one that is the Hindi, and another is that English or any classical language also, like a Sanskrit or a English, that kind of a thing. Okay, so that language should be there. And one thing I think you must be knowing, and that generally people used to say that the Hindi is a national language. So do you know which one is the English national language of India? Any people can reply, which language is the national language?
Hindi, sir.
Hindi, sir.
No.
Hindi, sir.
No, it's not
final
a
Hindi. Final language, sir.
No language is deemed as a national language. Like that. So, kisi bhi language ko we have not given. We have means the Constitution of India and the Parliament of India. Okay, have not given the status of a national language. Hindi is the official language, hai na? And apart from the Hindi, there are several official language of government of India. Okay, like that, when you will go to the Jharkhand, you may not be knowing, the official language of Jharkhand is Hindi, first official language. And the second official language of Jharkhand is Odia. Some of you may not be knowing, but the second official language of Jharkhand is Odia. Okay. So like that, the every state they have a official language, and similarly the government of India, for the whole nation, we have a official language. Apart from Hindi, there are other languages also. Okay, even the Odia is also one of the official languages of government of India. So there are some other languages. So Hindi is the official language, not a national language. But this is not our point of discussion. Our point of discussion was that when we talk about the recommendation of this committee, says that there should be general spectrum, vocational spectrum. So general spectrum mein language will come, and the other subjects from the science, social science and humanities will come. So this should be a part, like that the science mein physics, chemistry, mathematics, biology, and the social science, history, geography, kind of a thing. So this should comprise of general spectrum courses. And the vocational spectrum means the component from the vocational courses. Okay, so this should be there. Like that, in the vocational education, we have seen that the committee was in opinion that the courses, vocational courses related to the manufacturing industries and the engineering stream, that should not be offered, because there is already a huge unemployment of people, those who are coming from the ITI, Polytechnic and the engineering colleges. So there is a huge unemployment, so that's why this type of vocational courses should not be run. And apart from that, it requires a more rigorous kind of academic practice, whereas the courses related to the managerial, commercial, health and paramedical, rural occupation, agriculture, that kind of a courses may be offered. So these type of a courses will come under the vocational spectrum. Okay, So they recommends that either the general spectrum and a vocational spectrum of a courses may be offered, or a mix of spectrum may also be offered. Mix of spectrum means there will not be very clear cut vocational course, but the vocational aspect will be inbuilt in the subject. Like that, when we are studying the science, then suppose that we are studying some concept. So what are the utility of those concept in the different occupation, different day-to-day life, working life of the person. So this type of structure may be adapted. And when they talk about the structure, they also talk about that what should be the weightage of the different component in the course. Like that, we have already discussed yesterday that there should be, their suggestive is that there is a two type of stream is possible. One stream is that the existing structure we should continue, and we should include the SUPW that was recommended by the Iswarbhai Patel committee. Otherwise, what we can do, that we should vocationalize the secondary education, means the vocational input will be there, like that the, from the agriculture and the paramedical and the clerical, all those things that right now I have talked about. So this type of a scheme is also possible, or the including the SCPW is also possible. So they have suggested a structure like that. If you are going with the SUPW, then the 15% of weightage of the total component of the secondary education, the 15% of a weightage should be given for the SUPW. Then the next 15% of the weightage should be given to the language, and then the remaining 70% of the weightage will be for the electives. Electives may be from the different subjects from the general spectrum. Okay, so this type of a combination is also possible, and they are giving the structure of distribution if you are going for the SUPW component. However, if you are not opting for the SUPW and you are vocationalizing the secondary education, there is no such structure is mentioned in the document. It means that the state or the central government, those who are adopting the vocationalized course, they are free to determine the structure. And obviously, there is no much scope of determining, because it suggests that there will be language, there will be some general courses, and the majority of the part will be the vocationalized content from the agriculture, paramedical, clerical, commercial, like that. So obviously the majority of the weightage will be given to the vocationalized course, not to the other. There will be only, I think, 15-20% to the language and the other things. Okay, so it has been left out to the board, to the state, and to the implementing authority. Because when we were discussing the four major central finding of this document yesterday, we had already seen that this document says that the carefully preparation for the vocationalization of a secondary education will be decided appropriately by the respective board and the government, that is the state government or a central government. So that's why here it is not a matter of discussion, but the structure that they have proposed is 15% for the language, 15% for SUPW, and the rest 70% is for the elective courses from the general spectrum. So that was the another finding. The next finding of this document says that since we are vocationalizing the secondary education. Means we are thinking that after coming out from the plus two, vocationalized plus two, either the student will go for, means the person who are coming will go for self-employment, or they will search the employment opportunity in some of the organization, agency, like that the factory, company, or a government sector, or wherever it is available. So that may be also possible. And the third possibility may be that they may think of pursuing higher education in that, like that coming out of just from the plus two, they may think of pursuing the polytechnic, they may think of after that pursuing the graduate courses, postgraduate courses, even up to the research. Okay, so that's why this document recommends three things. First thing is that we have to align the recruitment policy, rules, regulation, or policy as per the existing situation. Means the recruitment policy must be in a such a fashion that the student coming out of from the secondary education, vocationalized secondary education, they must get opportunity. If they will not get opportunity, then obviously the student will be demotivated and they won't pursue the vocationalized secondary education. So that's why the recruitment policy of the company, of the different agency, must be aligned, and they must be given instruction as like that. So this should be one of the things. And the next thing is that there should be a proper facility should be created for the vertical mobility in the vocational education. It is not like that I will pursue some health like that ophthalmology, and like that those who measures that power of this glass, ophthalmology that course is known as. So that the like that we think about the ophthalmology. So if the person has taken this vocational course as a plus two level, then there must be some other courses at a higher level for their vertical mobility. Suppose that I pursued and I am interested to pursue the higher education in the ophthalmology, and so opportunity must be there. Okay, so this is the also one of the major recommendations of this committee, that this kind of arrangement should be made. Otherwise, if this kind of arrangement is not there, then there will be no much benefit of offering this type of courses. So like that it should be done. Then the third thing that I was talking about, that providing them employment opportunity, self-employment opportunity, entrepreneurship. So that's why when you will see the elective courses in the vocationalized secondary education structure, you will find that there is a emphasis on the entrepreneurship courses. So that will be also a part of the vocationalized secondary education, so that they will learn some of the basic skill for establishing their own industry, agency, or a firm, or such kind of a thing. Okay, so that is also there, and they will be supported also. That's why you will find that there is a even still there is a facility of drawing a loan out of your certificate. From 10th or 12th certificate, you can draw some loan for a business. It is to enable them to entrepreneur something, like that you can start with a small business or a small thing. So in order to promote those things, this type of a component should be also included in the vocationalization of a secondary education. That is the one of the thing, because the government knows that there is a not much employment opportunity that time. It is when in the 78s I am talking. So that time there was a very less scope in the government sector. There was also very less scope in the private sector also. So you cannot be dependent upon those things with the government or the existing factory. We should also equip them with a skill of entrepreneuring, so that they will establish their own business. They will establish their own establishment for getting the employment opportunity, and they will also offer the employment opportunity to others. That is the also one of the inbuilt beauty of promoting for the entrepreneurship. You are not only getting the employment opportunity for yourself, rather than you are also giving the employment opportunity to the others. So that is the also one of the beauty. And this thing I have discussed. And the next thing is two things they talk about, that they talk about the principle of principle and scope of higher education, higher secondary education. Okay, what are the governing principle of what should be the governing principle of higher secondary education as per this committee report? The governing principle means, governing principle means the principle on which the recommendations are based upon. The principle on which the recommendations are based upon, because they are recommending that there should be the SUPW, there should be the vocationalization, there should be the entrepreneurship component, and the other things that I think 6-7 recommendations we have seen. These are the only major recommendation, and no, there is no such major recommendation apart from that. These are the 7 are the major recommendation of this committee, report of this committee. But the governing principle and the scope of secondary education talks that why they are suggesting this type of a recommendation, why they are recommending, and their recommendation is based upon the certain principle. The there are I think 4-5 principle that is mentioned in the document, but the principle that are relevant for us from the vocationalization point of view, that only we will discuss. And they talks that the secondary education that we will offer to the children of a country, that must be aligned with the national goal of the country. National goal must reflect in the secondary education that we are offering, because it's if it won't reflect, then whatever the national goal that we have set out to achieve for the betterment of a country, that will not be fulfilled, and that will become a hindrance for the development of a country. So one of the governing principle of this document were that the secondary education that we are offering, that must conform the national goal of the India. And the national goal of the India at that time, as emphasized in the document, were the removal of unemployment. It was one of the national goal, because at that time the majority of a person were the below poverty level. However, they talk that there is a 50% of a population is below the poverty level at that time, 78 I am talking. this is the official document, but even you will find that some other document, it talks that at that time it was more than that. So you can just think of that the majority of our population, or even we rely on this document, the 50% of the population is below poverty level. So how we will fight with the poverty? We cannot distribute the money, and distributing the money is not an option to fight with the poverty, because how much and how many time we will give the money? We will give the free scheme, freebies. So one of the effective measure of fighting with poverty is to equip them to earn money, to give them some skill so that they can work. And that's why this document talks that in order to remove the unemployment, we should give them a vocational training so that either they can get an employment opportunity in the government sector, non-government sector, or they can start their own work, and they should give the employment opportunity to the others even. So this is the one of the governing principle of this document where. Another governing principle that just now I was talking, so it is linked with that. So the another government governing principle of this document says that the removal of destitution literally means that it the worst condition of a poverty is a one thing that the poor peoples are there, the sum of the population are poor, those who are not meeting the energy need, if we see that from the energy perspective, that the calorie is required, daily calorie, the energy they are not getting. If we are talking from the economic point of view, so the required level of income, per day income or per month or per annum income is not there. Okay, or if we talk from the nutrition, so the nutritious food is not available. Whatever the parameter we should use, that at that time the population, majority of the population were poor, they were below the poverty line, and that's why they talks about the removal of the destitution. Destitution is the worst form of a poverty. One thing is a poverty. The worst form of a poverty is known as the phenomena is known as the destitution. Because 50% or more than 50% are below the poverty line. So it's a very worst situation. If we see that when you will, because I used to come from Acharya Vihar, between the Acharya Vihar and Sainik School, that turning, when you will go that, you will find that in one side, that is the adjacent to the Utkal University boundary, there is a whole slum. So they are not earning as sufficient as required. They are below the poverty line. And you think that if you will go anywhere, and you will find that the 50% population are like that, so what will be the situation? So that this document also talks about that the education system that we are having, that must remove the destitution, means they should equip them to earn money, earn livelihood. If it is not providing, then that kind of education doesn't mean anything, and that's why they have taken it as a guiding principle. Another guiding principle that is very relevant to here is that for the rural development, because for the we know that the majority of the population of India resides in the rural area, and they are dependent upon the agriculture. So how that agriculture will be, agricultural practices will be enhanced, uplifted by training them, motivating them, orienting them with the latest practices and technology in the area of agriculture. So that must be there. And that's why they have, when they were suggesting what kind of courses should be there in a vocational education, they have suggested the courses related to the rural areas and the courses related to the rural development and the agricultural practices, so that they should be uplifted and they should be brought into the mainstream of the society and the nation. So these were the principal governing the higher secondary education as per this document. Apart from that, they also talks about the different type of courses that already I have discussed. They also talks about that what kind of a foundation and a vocational courses should be there. It is not something like that that needs explanation, so that I will send and that you will get it. Okay, so I think this is all about that. I wanted to talk about this committee report. Now we will have a question answer session. So if you have any question, you can just write, ask me any question. Yes, please.